Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Hallelujah. Now, I know that First English isn't a normal, traditional Lutheran church, so there's a lot of people who aren't aware of that greeting. It's an ancient greeting that Christians would say to them, to each other in the early days. And it's meant to announce this beautiful day that we are celebrating. So when someone says, Hallelujah, Christ is risen, your response can be, Christ is risen indeed, Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Speaking of Hallelujahs, we give great thanks to God for Ethan this day. Ethan is going to be baptized into this family of Christ on this Easter Sunday. His brother and his dad have also been baptized here, and so we're incredibly grateful to celebrate with them and the whole Wynn family and the whole Fetters family. We're just so grateful to be able to celebrate with that today. We've got our normal Bible studies this week, 9:30 on Sundays. Tuesday at noon, we'll be gathering again back in the Fellowship Hall because that Fellowship Hall space just opened up about half an hour ago. I'll talk about that in a minute. So that's noon, and then at 7 o'clock, we have Zoom Bible study. The reason that that space is cleared up is because the good people at Third Shift, the Warming and Cooling Center, have completed their winter service here. They've been utilizing our fellowship hall for a little over a month now, and the Columbus Shelter Board shuts all of the warming centers down at the end of March, today, March 31st. We are hopeful that they can get back into the fellowship hall soon, maybe in the next couple of months, if they can get the cooling center up and running. If not, then towards the end of the year, when winter comes, they will be back. We are so grateful to have been able to be a part of the work that they are doing. So if anybody from the Third Shift is here, thank you for the work that you've done. A big thank you to Winfield and the people of Zion Lutheran Church who are in the house. Thank you. Really grateful Pastor John is here. He let me know that he's got an incredible word to bring during the sermon. just kidding. It'll be me. I also want to thank Winfield's friends. I thought they were from an Elks Lodge, but you said something else today. Okay, so thank you to that crew, to both men and women that helped. Helping hands as well. Thank you all so much. On April 21st, we're having a work day. Peace Lutheran Indiana is coming down, helping us out. John Bradley will have lots of projects for us. You are welcome to join us. That'll be after worship on the 21st. Of April, so do join us for that. On April 17th, there is an opportunity to learn about racism and how to be anti-racist and talk about such things. That's on April 17th. Check your email. We'll just be sending that out again. It was in your last one as well. And finally, you may notice some random Easter eggs around here. The Ezra Bunny, I mean the Easter Bunny, placed a few eggs around. So if you see them laying around, those are actually meant for you to find and enjoy. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. Rudy, let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Buenas tardes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good day.
Just want to remind you, we have concerts on May 5th at the Columbus Arts Museum. If you want to come and hear something exciting and new, you're very welcome to come. If you don't want to hear anything exciting and new, you can come anyway. It's beautiful music and you probably like it. Okay, I just need my glasses.
invite you to rise in body or spirit.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Hallelujah.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who writes the law on our hearts, who draws all people together through our risen Jesus Christ. Amen. We are held in God's mercy, so let us trust in God and confess our sin quietly as we pray. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts and we let hurts grow into hatred. For all of these things and for the sins only you know, forgive us, dear Lord. Amen. Here is a flood of grace, dear siblings in Christ. Out of love for the entire world, God draws near to us. God breaks every snare of sin. God washes away all our wrongs. And God restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ, in whom we are offered forgiveness. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen.
Our triumphant, holy day.
Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear not only to the not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Any kids want to come forward? So that was fascinating, huh? Could you believe how holy that was? Super incredibly, like did you see like the angels? It was a tap water, folks. It was just a sink. And you know, that's all it is, right? Or is it? It's not. We call it holy water because when we're gathered around the font, that's what this is called, with people to proclaim God's love, it's that promise of God with this water that makes it holy. Mm-hmm. So it could be muddy water and still be holy.
It could have gross stuff in it and still be holy as long as it didn't hurt Ethan. Holy is because God has said, this water is special for you today. Because you are special today. Because Ethan is special today. But also, that holiness then gets attached to Ethan. And he then gets to live knowing that he is holy. Just like you're holy. Because I know you guys have been baptized, right? And anybody else who wants to be baptized can be baptized. We can always baptize you if you haven't been, because this holy water, even though it's special and set apart, it's for all, everyone. We're also going to anoint Ethan with a little bit of oil on his head. And that's another way to say, Ethan, you are beloved. And then we're going to give him a candle, kind of like a birthday candle, but for his baptismal birthday. And we'll light that, and we'll say, let your light so shine. And we're just reminding him that every year on this day, March 31st, he can remember that he was playing in this holy water, and the light of Jesus shines in him. And he can light this every year if he wants on his baptismal birthday, the 31st. So, I hope that helps you understand what we're going to be doing a little bit later. And it's all connected to this day of Easter, where we remember that Jesus conquered death, Jesus rose to new life, and Jesus is leading us into the future as his holy people, blessed in the water, gifted by the word, and sent out into the world with God's love. All right, amen. Let's pray. And say, dear God, thank you so much for giving us water and your holy promise. Be with us today as we celebrate new life in the risen Christ and in the baptized Ethan. We love you. Amen. Thank you all for coming up.
I invite you to rise in body and spirit. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, Lord. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought hot spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go and tell the disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of Jesus, our risen Savior. Jesus, the one who calls us from death to life. Jesus, the one who leads us into the eternal love of God. Amen. I want to start out with a little bit of Bible facts. It's really not kind of a sermon, but it might help you stay unconfused, or I hope it doesn't make you more confused. But if you have been an avid reader of the Bible and have read Mark, you're probably a little bit confused why the resurrection story ended right there. Because your Bible actually has more verses in it after that. But this is actually the end of the original Mark. And I could do an entire, we could probably do a couple of Bible studies just on how the Bible is made and the different theories about it. But what's important to know and to note, especially in a world where you hear the loudest Christians saying the Bible is inerrant and the Bible is infallible, well, the reality is that we can very clearly know, as best we can know anything that was written thousands of years ago, that the person who wrote Mark ended at this verse. And you might understand why other people added to that, because this is not a very comfortable way to end the resurrection celebration. So if you go back to your Bible after worship today, or if you decide not to listen to me and read it right now, you'll see that there are I think there are 20 verses total, and you'll get other stories. But they're clearly written in a different voice, and they're clearly trying to clean up the mess that Mark left. Because the way Mark ends, it really does feel like death won in some ways. At least that's what the women seem to be experiencing, because even though they were told Jesus is raised from the dead, they went away with terror and amazement. Terror. Which I think we all can understand. Whether it's because of this angelic figure that announced Jesus' resurrection, or whether it's because you believe you are literally losing your mind because you might be believing that this guy who had been dead is actually alive again. You can understand why people wouldn't be comfortable with the end of the story, especially since, as you understand the Greek, one of my old professors wrote a whole book on how this might have come about. And he thinks that actually we are missing the ending and the beginning, because a lot of them were written on scrolls, but Mark apparently was written in codex, which is the book form. And Dr. Clayton argues that it actually ends like this. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. For you see. Yeah. I don't know about you, but if that's what and I don't know Greek well enough to know that he's right, but he teaches at a seminary. So I think he's right. That it ends with, for you see. For you see what? For you see, I don't see anything, his body's gone. For you see. That tells me that whether Mark wanted us to build out our own story, or whether Mark somehow had his work ruined, one way or another, there was more to the story. One way or another, there was more to what Jesus had been doing. But during that same time, they didn't know what was happening. And those women who showed up at the tomb had no idea what to expect. They weren't expecting to find an empty tomb. They were expecting to anoint his body. They just spent good money on oil. They were planning to anoint him for burial. And then he's gone. Kind of like the last bit of Mark in some way. And I really wonder if, in the beginning, people who first read that wondered, where is this really going? What is happening here? Because so many of them had built their hope, had built their lives, had built their faith, and even had begun building a revolution based on this man named Jesus Christ, who was leading them in a way that they had never seen. anybody knew them, and was doing it in such a way that it actually threatened the systems of power that had been oppressing them and holding them down. And so in the midst of that worry and fear, they didn't know what was coming after this. All they knew is their rabbi, their leader, their teacher had been killed by the state, and their hopes for new life had been vanquished. The story seemed to be over. But you and I are still sitting right here, so we know that that story did continue. We know that that story did continue because throughout the ages, the story that those women told began to spread even further, even through the men who were not inclined to listen to women. They told the story so that you might hear it today, 2,000 years later. They told the story with confidence, whether or not they had the ability and the societal capital to be able to put it down in writing so that others might be able to hear it in their own words. These people didn't know what was coming, and yet, somehow, they also had a sense that the story would continue. In the midst of their fear, they had some amazement as they head back and said nothing to anyone. But apparently, eventually, they did. And that's one of the things that I think we can cling to, is knowing that if these women and the disciples had lived in the face of this kind of violence and death and had their movement come to a screeching halt because of what the authorities had done to Jesus, they might have easily thought that that story would truly end. I don't know about you, but if what I had been believing in suddenly crumbled, I would have second thoughts, and I'm not sure I'd be able to continue to tell the story myself. But that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. The Holy Spirit meets us where we are, even in the midst of our doubt, even in the midst of our despair, even in the midst of our amazement and terror, even in the midst of our foolishness. The Spirit works in us to help us to see that those things in front of us, those unknowns, those anxiety-causing troubles, those, while they seem to be death-dealing and the end of the story, they are not. It's the day of Transvisibility today, every March 31st is. It happens to fall on an Easter Sunday. And some of the trans people I follow have been talking about this already on Easter morning on social media. And one of my favorite pastors, Pastor Laura Groom, said, The resurrection of Jesus is not like coming out of the closet as a trans person. It is like it, though. It's not actually like it, but it's sort of. It's a both and sort of thing. Because what happens? A trans person is in the closet. They see no way forward. I've seen this time and time again. There is no way forward. They don't see a way to the other side. They can't come out and be themselves and be authentic, so they can't live. Or if they do come out, they're in danger and they might lose their family or friends. There seems to be no way to do it. There seems to be no end for many people who are trans. Well, what happens is they present to the world in the same body, but in a new way. You still see them as the beautiful human beings they are. With Jesus, we see the same thing. He is still the same, but he is different. He is raised. You can still put your fingers in his wound holes. That means that in the resurrection, when he was brought to new life by the Holy Spirit, when he rose again before he ascended to the Father, his body was not a perfect body. It was perfect, but it was not healed. There were still wounds. There was still evidence from what had happened to him. There was still evidence of human malice. That's the kind of thing that we face when we come out of whatever has been holding us back. Whether we have been in the closet for something like that, or our world seems like it's about to end, our marriage is crumbling, or we've lost our job. I just heard of some dear friends of mine that have been around since I've been here, just found out, just this week they lost their housing. They don't seem to know the way forward. They're reaching out for help. They're trying to believe. They're trying to believe. They're trying. They said that. We're trying to see a way forward. It's my hope and prayer that somehow the Spirit works for them in the way the Spirit works for so many of us tangibly. Because I don't know about you, but I wish that the resurrected Jesus would come back and heal all of this pain and suffering, heal all of the wounds, heal all of those who are hungry, bring liberation and freedom to all of those who do not have enough food, shelter, or liberty. It almost always in this world seems like the story is ending, does it not? Whether you're looking at the news or in the mirror, the days in front of us so often seem like they're filled with nothing but doom and gloom. And yet each morning we find ourselves once again facing the sun that rises day in and day out. And we see that in the midst of that new light and that new dawn, that we ourselves have a new beginning. And we ourselves have the opportunity to see the holy promise that we're going to kind of witness here, but in a new way. The holy promise that God is with every bit of water that is in our bodies. That promise of covenant and holiness is for each and every one of us, you and me, to help bring about the rest of the story. Because the story is not done yet. A phase of life might be done for you. An old way of being might be in your rearview mirror. Your future may not look the way you thought it was going to look, but you have a God that is bringing you forward into it and saying, you are beloved. Ultimately, when we begin to see that future, whether we are, as I was talking about before, a trans person who finally acknowledges the beauty of your own self and allows the world to see that beauty in a new way, you'll see new life then. It will, Jesus doesn't say it won't be painful. But he says he'll be with you, and he'll call you beautiful and beloved, and he'll help you make it happen. That's what happens when trans people come out of the closet. But it's also what happens when we begin to see that we work together and we can make new things happen together. And when we do that, sometimes history will be written about us, and other times nobody else will know except for you and God and maybe the person that was at your side when you were making a difference in a person's life. God is leading you forward. And you are continuing to write that story. You are not writing it down in holy ways like the writers of the Bible did so that someone else can compile it and eventually call it the Gospel of St. J. But you are living the Gospel of St. J. Or St. Charlotte. Or St. Rick. St. Mary, St. Ethan, you are living it. You are writing the story now because you have been touched by this news that death did not have the final word. While the story looked over, while it appeared to be done, it was not done, and you are still writing it. Because Jesus Christ is found in your heart, whether you know it or not, he is there leading you forward and bringing you to wholeness and bringing you to new life and bringing you to the point of being able to bring that love and that freedom and that grace and that liberation to everyone else, because that's how we do it together. We do it together. And we do it together because Jesus has called us together. And Jesus has called us together because God, because Jesus sees how beautiful each of us are. But he also knows that we're most beautiful when we are together in love. The same love that drew Jesus up from the grave. The same love that created you. The same love that promises the that for eternity, in light of Jesus' resurrection, for eternity, your joy is secure. Amen.
rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. Who presents Ethan for baptism? We do. As you bring Ethan to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, to bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach him the Lord's Prayer and the Creed and the Ten Commandments, and place in their hands the Holy Scriptures. Nurture them in faith and prayer, so that Ethan may learn to trust God in healthy ways. Proclaim Christ through word and deed as Paul, and care for others in the world God so loves as Abel, and to work for justice and peace at our side. Do you promise to help Ethan grow in the Christian faith and life for the sake of the world God so loves, as you are able? If so, reply, I do. Do you promise to nurture Ethan in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit, and help them live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church respectfully as they grow into their own understanding of faith? And now, people of God, do you promise to support Ethan and pray for him in his new life in Christ? If so, we do.
We do.
Now I invite you to rise in body and spirit. You're invited to respond with the words in bold on the screen as you so call. Do you renounce the devil and all forces that defy God, the powers of the world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? And so, say, we renounce them.
We renounce.
Do you claim God's love and all the joys Jesus desires for you, the powers of this world that co-create with God, and the ways of grace that draw you deeply into the work of the Holy Spirit? We do. If the Apostles' Creed is part of your faith, you're invited to join us in our confession out loud or in the silence of our hearts. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Son, and Twin. I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved child of God, you belong to Christ, in whom you have been baptized. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give your children new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to new life. Sustain Ethan with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Ethan, child of God, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever.
Amen.
And now, the candle I was telling you all about. Each day on his birthday, you are welcome to light this candle in remembrance of this special day, and remember the light of Christ that is within him and us all. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Now let us welcome this new baptized child of God. We welcome you to the body of Christ and in the mission you share.
We give thanks and praise to God, God's creator and redeemer to all the world.
Amen.
Congratulations, Ethan, Mom and Dad, and big brother Joseph. We're so grateful to have you as part of our.
Long for good news. Roll away the stones that keep
people from living with dignity and wholeness. Breathe new life and hope into people struggling to make it through each day. Feed those who are hungry and shelter those without. God of grace, hear our prayer. Loving God, we pray for this community of faith here at First English Lutheran and for Zion Lutheran. We give you thanks for that community of faith as we are joined together this day. We thank you for all of the communities of faith that support the work that you are doing here on East Main Street. And for your spirit in our midst, we thank you. Feed us at your Easter table, O God, and fill us with your wisdom, that we may continue to serve and care for others. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For what else do the people of God pray?
Loving God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit. Father God, who made this most holy night to shine with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church that spirit of adoption which is given to us in baptism, that we, being renewed both in body and mind, may worship you in sincerity and truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we can celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection, may be raised from death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you as the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
God of grace,
hear our prayer.
That way at all.
creature. Through you, the shadows of death have fled away, and life is given to all. The gates of heaven are flung open. God becomes man, and man is raised up to the likeness of God. O divine Pash, O Pash, light of new splendor, the lamps of our souls will no more burn out. The flame of grace, divine and spiritual, burns in the body and soul, nourished by the resurrection of Christ. We beg you, O Christ, Lord God, eternal King of the spiritual world, stretch out your protecting hands over your holy church and over your holy people. Defend them. Defend us. Keep us. Preserve us. Raise up your standard over us, and grant that we may sing with Moses the song of victory. For yours is the glory and the power for all eternity. Amen.
God of grace, Most High God, who sits high and looks low, you care for all of your people, and today we remember those who have gone before us in death. We trust, O God, that though the story for them appears to be ended, you and me continue to write even their story, as we trust that they are joyfully and peacefully comforted in your care. Renew our trust in your promises such as these, that during this life we may live with joyful courage and compassion. God of grace, hear our prayer. In your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. If you have not been a part of First English worship services before very often, at this moment it's going to feel like the worship service is over. It is decidedly not. One of the most beautiful parts of our community, well, actually the Charity of Peace is beautiful too, but we also have a meal after this, Holy Communion, which is an opportunity for you to receive the bread and the cup, which is Jesus Christ for you. So know that if you need to leave, you are welcome to. But there is more to the service. This isn't the afterwards social hour. This is sharing of God's peace with each other. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's share sign up.
Hey, Thank you. Christian does a great job.
He's with you.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God, and they are for you, the people of God. A few notes on how this will go. You're welcome to be seated. Brother Arnold and I will be coming down, and we'll bring we'll bring some communion juice. A person in the front row, if you're towards the back or anywhere else, you can wave your hands on coming down, and we can bring you communion as well. If you have not had communion with us before, this is non-alcoholic grape juice in the cups, and there's a wafer on top. It's a mystery to open. It's a mystery. It's not the easiest thing, and you're not alone. If you struggle with it, there's probably someone nearby who can say, "Help me out here," and know that we would love to help you out with that. So this is a meal for everyone because it is Jesus' offering, Jesus' meal. You all are welcome. You're not expected or required, but you're welcome. If for some reason you're not comfortable, I can offer you a blessing in the name of Christ. Just cross your arms on your chest and lean your head forward if you want me to make a sign of the cross on your forehead. But you are welcome. After you've received this, receive the cup and bread, you are welcome to either stand off to the side, come up here and kneel and pray, or consume it back at your seat. There is no right or wrong way. The only right way is how you prefer to do it. And now, the risen Christ is made known to us in the breaking of the bread. Come and eat at God's table.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take
Rejected and alone, like a rose, it's true. Rejoice and be glad. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.